Hello and welcome back to my channel where I primarily discuss changes to Unity Reflect and other Unity products that affect the AEC industry. In today's video, we have a really exciting content update because on Thursday, April 22nd, Unity Reflect was actually just split into two unique products. Now, instead of just Unity Reflect, we'll have Unity Reflect Review and Unity Reflect Develop. This video today is going to be for the out-of-the-box experience, covering the features that are involved with Unity Reflect Review. For the developer audience out there, Unity Reflect Develop is going to be more in line with you, and that is going to be for making your own custom experiences using the features existing with Unity Reflect. Using the technical school model, like one of my previous videos, I'm going to jump right in and I'm going to show you some of the way that the user interface has changed and what those features do. So right away, first things first, top left, you have your folder icon. This is going to get you to your cloud dashboard for all your projects. Right after that, we have our help mode, and in the help mode, you can click on any icon and get a nice tooltip for what that does. I'm not going to click on every single one individually because I'm going to actually go through the sharing experience and show you what each one actually does. Here we have the sharing icon, the live sync icon. This is an existing feature from the very first version of Unity Reflect. What it does is when you have it activated, you get a live link back to the Revit model. So this way, if you're out in the field with a remote device or you're sharing the viewer with someone else, which I'll show how to do later in the video, activate this and anything that happens in real time from the Revit model will be seen in the viewer model. Next, we've got our filters. With the filters, they're really great because what you can do is select a category and instantly highlight what that category is. So if I click on the furniture, I can isolate it, and then I can click the other button, what looks like the eye, and turn the visibility on and off. What we also did here is having the search filter. So you can type in a category or something that if you have a heavily dense model, you know, I typed in lighting fixtures here, I can get right to it, and then with that, isolate them, do the same thing, turn them on and off. Okay, next in line with our scene options, we have the ability to turn on and off textures. And why this is useful is that if you have a really, really dense model and you're bringing it into the Reflect Viewer, particularly on mobile devices where memory is limited, you may want to use this feature to quickly get to your area of interest. And once you navigate it there, you can turn textures back on and in this way optimize your loading times. And then the next thing we have is the light data. So toggling this on and off, again, can optimize your loading times, but it just allows you to turn on and off the lights that you have the data loaded into your Revit model. Next in line is the sun study. So with the icon on the left, we get this nice horizontal slider way to manipulate the time of day as I'm doing right here, or even the time of year. And you can see on the bottom of the screen as well that we do have the clock and the month and the day of the month that shows as we actively slide these. Now, if you prefer what may feel to some like a more intuitive feel of a wheel using the sun study, that's why we also incorporated the feature to the right side menu buttons. And doing this allows you to turn a dial, if you will, for hours of the day and months of the year. In the bottom left, you'll notice this eye for the stats info. This is a handy little feature because first thing it'll do is just tell you what version you're on. Right now, we're on 2.1.0. And so this just lets you know that, hey, you're up to date. We've got 5 or 6 official releases of Reflect now. So this will let you know that for the April Thursday 22nd release, 2021, we're on version 2.1.0. The other thing is that because Reflect can go into VR, AR, desktop, there's a lot of different hardwares and devices that can use Reflect. It's really great to be able to track your FPS. So right now I'm tracking at 99. It's a small, it's a lightweight model, and I'm running this on Alienware RTX, so naturally it's going to be pretty high. Now on the right side of the screen, this set of features, the first two from top down, are all about navigation. We wanted to really improve and optimize the way you navigate the model. So the first one lets you really pivot and rotate around a centralized point wherever you start. In this way, you're rotating the model around you. Now, if you click the button below it, you're staying static at that point. And so in this way, you can either rotate the model around you or rotate your camera in one place where you start. So it gives you a couple of different options to really change the way you get to feel and interact with the model. You also still have the freedoms of WASD. Move your 3D camera through the space as freely as you want. And so you have several different ways to get about. Now the BIM information menu is great because if you've been around and you've been tracking Reflect or you own Reflect since the first release, you know, one of the most powerful features that Reflect does is it actually exports the entire model from Revit, Navis, Rhino, SketchUp, BIM 360, whatever model you're using, it takes the entire model, but it takes the entire set of metadata with that model. And so we've added the ability to access that information. And so here I opened up the menu and literally anything I click on, its information will be populated in this menu. Moving right along, I've teleported outside the building now, and the last feature that we have here on the right is the measure tool. A very simple but necessary tool to have. You know, this could help you with on-site measurements if you're going into AR. Very easy to use, point and click two areas, and you can click and drag to extend or shorten. It has a nice snap to feature, so it feels good whenever you get to a point of interest. And then also just using the 3D camera to pivot about could allow you to see things through this form of visualization that you might not see with a 2D measure tool and some other sort of platform. All right, now as we get to the bottom right, you're gonna notice that there's this wing looking icon. And so if I click that, what's gonna happen is a new set of buttons opens up. And some of them are probably more obvious than others, like AR, and as you could probably guess, right above that is VR. But the wing and the feet are a couple of new ones that I wanna talk about. So I just clicked the wing, and what it did is it brought me back to my origin point, which is a good segue into going to the cube at the top right, which I didn't cover earlier. And so what we do here is that this just gives you your different orientations of the model with a quick click based on how they're defined in Revit. And so going back down now, if we open the wing back up, which as you probably noticed right there is the same as the home, the base orientation, I wanna take you into one of the newest features, which is walk mode. So the 2 feet should be pretty intuitive. It's gonna snap you into place. And this is really great because if maybe you want to share this 3D model for someone who's never used a 3D viewing software, they're not used to, or they don't feel comfortable using WASD on the keyboard, you know, this could be a way that they jump right in and it feels intuitive with their feet planted on the ground and they get this one-to-one scale experience. Now, right here, I walked up to the glass because I wanted to point out the fact that in walk mode, you cannot walk through walls, whereas you can with the typical 3D fly camera, you can fly through it. But what makes walk mode unique in that sense is that you can walk upstairs and you will scale the way the terrain is laid out. Okay, so next going back to the icon here with the different options we have, I clicked VR here. I don't have a VR headset, so there's nothing that Reflect is going to identify here, so that's why it says missing open XR setup. If I did have an Oculus or an HTC Vive, that button would pop me right into VR seamlessly, no extra work necessary, very nice, very convenient. All right, now AR is grayed out because I'm using this viewer on my desktop. And so naturally there's no AR on a desktop. So what I did at this point is I actually switched and I cut the video here in the editing so that I recorded separately going into AR from my cell phone. And so this is captured on an iPhone 12 Pro. And what you see here when going into AR, now that the button's activated, is 3 ways to go into AR. We've got view match, corner match, and tabletop. Tabletop I'll show last because that's our earliest way, our original way of going into AR. And what I'll start with is corner match, which is actually the newest and most accurate. And so what we do here is we select our position of interest, then we select the floor. We wanna identify a horizontal surface that can be identified as the floor. The third step is that we want to get a left-facing wall and a right-facing wall, A and B. And once that's done, we go into the real world through the camera of the device. And with iPhone 12 Pro, it's really great because it has LiDAR on board. I identified the floor, and then I'm going to match up and align walls A and B so that this feature now thinks that the virtual positioning that I did of Reflect is what it really is in real life. And so although I'm in my living room doing this, obviously I'm not in this school, you can see how this can be taken to an actual corn shell of a building, even an existing building that's up for renovation. And by using corner matching, it's a very quick, very convenient, extremely easy way to jump into one-to-one scale AR without having the hassle or complication of printing out image trackers, printing them out, placing them in the model, then going to the site and placing them in the real life position where they need to be. Now, that is an extremely way to do AR, extremely accurate way to do AR. However, this is a very clean, like I said, convenient way to jump right in, and it's quite good, especially if you're using the new hardware like LiDAR-enabled devices. It can be quite accurate. So then the second way we go into AR is with something we call view match. This is really great if you are standing sort of at a distance from the model and you want to look. It's internally, sometimes we call it our parking lot mode. And so what I did right there is similar to tabletop. I just found a horizontal surface, and that's all you have to do. It jumps right into a full scale version of the model. And you notice, like I said, parking lot view. It's, you know, this is what I'm representing right here, being outside of the model, looking back in. So this along with tabletop are definitely the shortest time to get to AR. And so here the last way we do it, which if you're familiar with Reflect, you've seen this before, this is how we go into tabletop AR. The one thing that's different now, or two things rather, one is just the visual quality we've increased, but two, we now actually have the scale wheel available. So you're not stuck in that one original scale of the model. Previously we would pinch and zoom to change the scale of it, but now we have an accurate way with this wheel to rotate in and out of various scales. So all great ways to go into AR with your model, some more accurate than others, but you know, depending on what your use case is, if you're on site or if you're just showing someone next to you with a device, you've got very good options here to use within Reflect. Now, this next feature is probably, I mean, right next to the technology that AR brings, is probably the most exciting upgrade to Reflect. And that is the ability to share your model with someone else in a very easy way, and to actually have them join your same instance of Reflect. So before, you'd have two separate instances if you were to invite someone in, and the process to inviting them was several steps. Now, all you do is click the share button from within the viewer. And so in this capture, I'm actually clicking that from my phone, and I click copy link. You can see the link copied to the clipboard. And what I did here is I opened my own Slack on my phone and I Slacked myself the link. I just pasted it. And once that was there, I was able to, now the video I've edited, switch back to my desktop recording. I've opened the link from Slack from my desktop. And just by clicking that link, it opens up Reflect automatically. I don't have to click anything from the dashboard page with my projects. It jumps right into the model that I'm in on my phone. And so here I am, I open it up, I start at the origin point. And another thing that you might notice is there's a microphone. And so Reflect is now voice enabled. You can actually do collaboration reviews without Zoom or any Teams or any sort of meeting software. It could all be done through Reflect. And now at this point, what's really interesting is that I chose to follow myself. So I'm actually following the camera view from my viewer on my phone. And the reason why it looks so fluid now is because on my phone, I went back into AR. I did view match AR, and so I'm in the parking lot mode. And from my desktop, this is the view that I'm seeing that's happening on my cell phone. This is an extremely powerful feature because if you wanted to show someone a point of interest and you wanted to quickly invite them and bring them in, if you're on site doing QA, QC, and you want to go into AR and show them what the virtual looks like with the real. All they have to do is click follow user, follow you, and then see what you're seeing in AR. And so that's a very exciting new feature. I love that feature. I think it's just incredible. If I stop following myself, I can go back to the origin point of the model. And as you see here, this is really neat. I zoom in and I find the other version of me sitting right here. And then now I start to take my phone and look around so I can look back at myself, my desktop version of myself. And so this is what it looks like to have multiple users in the same viewer. At this point, I close Reflect off my phone, and so my avatar will disappear. And what happens is you no longer see him, but me as the invitee from a desktop, you'll notice I'm still in the viewer. I could still keep going around even though the host has left. And so that's also a really nice feature to have with this. So that just about covers everything. We went through individually all the features, some old, some new, but since the last video I made, if you go back to my first workflow video, you probably notice a huge change, upgrade to UI and the visual quality of Reflect. Stay tuned for our June release, which we're going to be upgrading the visuals even more. It's going to be HDRP enabled. If you follow Unity, you know what that means, high definition render pipeline. Very exciting. A lot of big things happening here, so if you are interested in trying or using or upgrading your existing Reflect, I'll leave the links in the description. Definitely go upgrade your viewer if you already have it, but if not, I'll put all the information here available so you know how to contact us. So thanks for watching. Please subscribe if you're interested in seeing more updates and more videos like this. Take care.